Hello folks, I'm trying to do a video on Revelation chapter 22 verses 15, 14 and 15. It's a tough topic because it covers pretty much the afterlife in two verses and critical vital information, I think, in my opinion. It pretty much paints a picture of the righteous people being able to potentially enter into the kingdom of heaven and live for eternity, while the unrighteous people are outside. They don't get to enter into the kingdom of heaven or live for eternity. Instead, they cease to exist. So that's probably the first myth to dispel, is that God tortures people for eternity, millions, billions, trillions of years. That's ridiculous. It's completely absurd. I think it's kind of blasphemous too. And it's just bizarre that it's been embraced by the churches. But at the same time, it makes a lot of sense why the churches would embrace that. Especially, a lot of the pastors out there, or a lot of the denominations, for example, where they are dependent upon tithing revenue to pay for their mortgages, to pay off the bankers for the artificially inflated land prices of the buildings. So, you know, because they're part of the idolatrous economic system, their objectivity is being skewed, in my opinion, in these matters. So going back to this matter, okay, so they've got the tithing system. One of the ways to convince people that they should tithe is, are you robbing God? I've heard this numerous times over the decades in churches. And the question is, no, I'm not robbing God. There is no mandate in the Bible for anyone to give some teacher 10% of their income. That's absurd. There is a tithe system, but it's of the increase of the land in general. It's so basically what God is giving people through his knowledge and his skill, in that he designed the plants and the animals, and they multiply with very little effort. You can plow a field and that's hard. But today, there's giant combines that drive themselves around the farms and harvest the crops. I mean, one person's producing food for 1,000 people. You know, so this idea of tithing of the increase, it's still biblical. But even the tithe, it doesn't go to the priest. The whole 10% isn't for the priest. It's described in the Old Testament that it's broken. The tithe is a third part, for the orphans and the widows, and for the foreigners, a third part. And then the Levites, so those people engaged in ministerial, that could be anything related to the ministry. And then, there's the priests, the teachers, maybe a percent or two. So there's this huge disconnect between what the scriptures actually say and then what a lot of the denominations are teaching people they say. And it's because of idolatrous currency worship. And it's a wicked world. It's pervasively wicked. And, the economic system is a huge example of that. If you look at it with any objectivity, it's a system designed to enrich a few at the expense of the many. Greed is idolatry. And this is a scripture verse. No idolatrous person has any part, any inheritance in the kingdom of heaven. So again, back to the kingdom of heaven. So when Jesus comes back, he's going to resurrect everyone. He's going to recreate the earth. And then there's going to be this kingdom of heaven on that earth. So it's kind of confusing, right? Because when people think of heaven, they think, oh, it's up in the sky, it's in the heavens. No, the kingdom of heaven will be on a future new earth. It's going to be a kingdom, a realm of an area of land, approximately 1,500 miles in length and 1,500 miles in width. And it's going to be walled. And those walls are going to be very high, very, very high. There's going to be on each side three gates, and those gates are going to be made out of pearl. It's going to be a beautiful wall. It's going to be beautiful. This is the creator of the heavens and the earth creating a kingdom, and it's going to descend from heaven on a new earth. It's going to be phenomenal. He's had, it took him 6 days to create the earth and everything that, you know, we know in a decreated form today on it. He's had over hundreds of thousands of days to create the kingdom of heaven, which would be the new Jerusalem. And it's a region of land on a future new earth where some people, the righteous people, will potentially get to dwell in there and potentially have an inheritance in there and potentially eat of the fruit of the tree of life, which extends life potentially for eternity. A lot of potentialies, but again, this is about the future, and it's in the last few chapters of the book of Revelation. What else? It's important, it's in Revelation chapter 20, 21, and 22. So the destiny of mankind is to be resurrected on a new earth. And so conceptually, a new earth is similar to, more than likely, is at least as healthy environmentally as it was initially when God created the earth and he created Adam on the earth way back, 6,000 years ago. And Adam lived 930 years, and he didn't eat of the tree of life. So there's another important concept that I want to share with you. It stands to reason, logically, right? Everyone's resurrected at the resurrections. Even if they don't go inside and eat of the tree of life, inside the New Jerusalem, inside the kingdom of heaven, if they don't have access, they don't have a right to go in. Even if they're outside, they're potentially going to live 900 years. So that's a lot of time in a perfectly healthy body, mind, spirit, perfectly healthy, created, new by the Creator, without defect. For those people who are outside to really get to know other people and have healthy emotional or passionate relationships with other people. And so when those people grow old and they die, there's going to be a lot of funeral processions, because you're talking about maybe 100 billion people that are resurrected at the resurrections in a very short space of time. Over two resurrections, over 1,000 years between the resurrections, that gives the first resurrection those outside a chance to grow old and die, but they grow old in a community of people with like-minded characteristics, even if they're outside, and they get to live peacefully. So it's a blessing to be resurrected, even if it means that they're outside. Now, at the judgment day, you've got a vastly larger number of people logically that are being resurrected, potentially, let's say 70 billion. 70 billion people resurrected at Judgment Day, and most of them are outside the New Jerusalem. They could potentially live 900 years or so. Adam lived 930 years, Noah lived 950 years. So in the context of the scriptures, they could live for a while. And it seems like a long time, you know, compared to the 70, 80 year lifespan of throughout the earth that is currently the average. But it's not a very long time in the scope of eternity, because the people inside the New Jerusalem, the righteous people who chose to repent of their sins, to believe in Jesus Christ, to do the Father's will, those people could potentially live for millions, billions, trillions of years. Okay, so someone living for 900 years and compared to someone living for a billion years, you know, it's a blink of an eye in comparison. You know, eternal life is a gift of infinite value, if it's actually eternal. Logically, it's a gift of infinite value. There is nothing in the universe that is more important than attaining. Maybe not important, but more valuable. There's nothing in the universe more valuable than attaining the gift of eternal life. But there's a caveat to that, right? For people to have that gift, they can't be murderers, right? Because if they're murdering each other, they're not having the gift of eternal life, are they? They're dying. They're having, you know, right? I mean, so you can't have people with certain proclivities inside the New Jerusalem screwing things up over millions, billions, trillions of years. So what is Revelation chapter 22, verse 4, 15? It outlines five character traits that, that are pretty much indicative of people who would screw up something that lasts for millions, billions, trillions of years. The first one is sorcerers. So people, that sorcery has to do with drugs, okay? And if you haven't been paying attention, drugs are pervasive in the world today. They put drugs in the water, okay? Fluoride is a drug, especially when it's supposedly used for treatment of tooth decay, right? It's a supposedly a medicine. It's a drug. They put drugs in the food, okay? Caffeine. Caffeine is a drug, okay? They're extracting it from nature, making it unnatural, and then adding it back into processed foods. There are thousands of food additives, and many of them are drugs. They have physiological health effects that can occur over months. Withdrawal symptoms can occur over months. Look into that, okay? Because this is the first characteristic of those people who are outside, is that they are participating in sorcery. And so, you know, it's not clear. No, it's not clear. And the churches don't talk about it. And so, you know, I'm probably one of maybe a dozen people or two dozen people that you're going to find in English on YouTube talking about sorcery at all. What is it? You know, it's totally confusing what it is. It has something to do with sorcery. It has something to do with drugs. So there's illegal drugs, right? There's the drugs they put in the food that they create with laboratory equipment, that they take nature, they refine it into something else, and then it has physiological effects. It's effectively a drug. And it can have brain chemistry effects as well. Caffeine is a huge example. 9 out of 10 people in America in 2012 were said to be consuming caffeine each day. They're consuming a drug. They were drugged out of their minds. 9 out of 10 people. Now, that doesn't mean they're overdosing. It doesn't mean that it affected them, right? Modern man is meddling with our bodies, okay? Our body is composed of trillions of cells, each cell composed of billions of molecular machines. God, and they're self-replicating on a microscopic and a macroscopic scale, self-ordering on a microscopic and a macroscopic scale, and we're just meddling with them. You know, they do, like, just the minimal possible amount of testing that they can do to get a product on the market when it comes to drugs, food additives, whatever. Because their incentive, their motive is to profit. These are not non-for-profit corporations. Now, they could be. You could make food additives and food companies all be non-profit. The government, you know, society could say, hey, you have to be non-for-profit. But they don't. So they let them profit. And their goal is to make as much money as they can. It's $100 trillion industry over a person's lifetime. Each person, if they consume $10 worth of processed food a day, that's $250,000 over 70 years per person. So in America alone, it's $100 trillion dollar industry. It's big, big business. And so if they can make a 0.1% improvement in their sales by putting some chemical compound in processed foods that's going to enhance flavor, and then there's no accountability because the symptoms, the few people that it affects, and randomly affects, or it mixes with some other compound from some other food additive, from some other food, and then it has XYZ symptom. You know, how is that ever going to be traced back to them? When they're the only ones that are required to do any studies, and their studies are minimal. So no, there is no invasive studies. And now, not only are they drugging the food, and of course they're drugging with prescription drugs, pushing drugs left and right. And the illegal drugs, the government has been caught numerous times, intelligence agencies importing drugs into the United States, for example, shipping drugs around the world, guarding poppy fields in Afghanistan. Just complete bizarro world, okay, when it comes to drugs throughout the world. But they're meddling with the very structure of DNA so that the organisms themselves are altered to produce chemical compounds which can affect people's physiology. It can alter people's very genome potentially. And there's like very little oversight, very minimal oversight on these issues by any of the governments of the world. There's and again, $100 trillion. So they have the means to do the research into these things, and they're developing the technology to start manipulating in mass the genome of plants and animals, including people. So sorceries, that's your sorceries. And what aspect of those things is offensive to the Creator? I don't know exactly. You know, I don't know. Is he upset when, someone has a headache and they take medicine? I don't know. Is he upset when someone's taking heroin and, they lost a loved one and they developed a heroin addiction? I don't know. But there's a major issue there, and someone... someone, it would be nice if someone figured it out, and feel free to comment, and share your videos, I'd be glad to take a look at them. But that's just the first topic. And then the next one is sexual morality. And guess what's really pervasive today in the world? It's completely pervasive. Sexual immorality, promiscuity, prostitution, sex slavery, adultery, Oh God, it's just so widespread throughout the earth, the sexual perversions. And literally, there's billions of hours of pornography online. Jesus indicated that if anyone looked at a woman with lust in their hearts, they're committing adultery with them. And there are billions of hours of pornography on the internet. And so sexual morality is right there. And what exactly does that mean? You know, why can't a church, there's millions of paid, full-time Christian clergy. Millions. Why aren't they figuring these things out and telling the people what these things mean? I mean, that is what they do 2,000 hours a year, you know, 30, 40 years, 50 years of their lives. Figure out what it means, work together, figure it out, and then disseminate the information. Why isn't the church, why aren't they doing that? And there's very little detail. I mean, does the detail not exist? Because when I, you know, it's one word, sexual morality. What does it mean? You know, so there's this Jesus, right? As far as we know, he did not have children. He didn't have sexual relations. He was completely pure. As far as in that sense, there's no possibility that he. Because, you know, and honestly, it makes a lot of sense, right? Because he's the King of Kings, and if he had children, mankind, for the last few thousand years, would be making continual war on each other to trip over putting whoever, you know, said that they were his children on the throne of what, XYZ nation. You know, just because. So he chose not to, right? He chose not to take a wife. And as far as we know, you know, he never had anything to do with anything sexual. So it was a very high standard, potentially, from the Lord on what is sexual immorality. And so again, you know, we're talking about eternal life. So the stakes could not possibly be higher. Now the consequences, again, of not attaining eternal life is growing old outside the New Jerusalem, as far as the context of the scriptures goes. And then, right after people die, being cremated in the lake of molten sulfur. And yeah, there'll be these continual funeral trains going to the lake of molten sulfur to cremate people. And the rationale is, you know, people are in these healthy bodies, healthy minds, and they're growing old, they're developing intense passionate emotional relationships with many other people, and then those people are dying and they're taking them to the Lake of Molten Sulfur to be cremated. And there was lots and lots of unnecessary weeping and gnashing of teeth because people couldn't be bothered to figure these things out and just choose to do what's right before Jesus came back. So the other aspect of this is the rationale for it, the Lake of Molten Sulfur being a place of cremation. There's so many people resurrected, right? And more than likely, the vast, you know, maybe 70 billion or so are going to be cremated. They're going to have their part in the Lake of Molten Sulfur. They're going to, something like that, you know, some large tens of billions of people. And the point is, rather than, you know, have people living, you know, hundreds of years, and then someone dies, and then they create a mausoleum with statues and ornate, you know, because they've got hundreds and hundreds of years on their hands, you can imagine that they could build, you know, some absurdly surely awesome, you know, memorials for the people that they loved, because they have so much time on their hands, and, you know, the relationship potential there for intense, passionate relationships developing, spanning over hundreds of years. It stands to reason people's natural instinct would be to create, you know, these vast cemeteries, you know, to and memorials to remember those people that they cared about, or the influential people, or whatever, you know, the famous people, you know. And but God's not into any form of idolatry, right? So as a rule of thumb, people are going to be cremated in the lake of molten sulfur to prevent the practice of idolatry. It would be my guess. And again, these are all my guesses. You know, these are guesses. This is my interpretation, my understanding, best I can make at this point with the information I have available. So, what are the others? So the murderers, that's another group that's outside the New Jerusalem. So what does that mean? Oh, obviously murder, right? But does that extend to, you know, there's 7 million people starving on the earth right now. And they could be fed for just a small fraction of the amount of money spent on the Iraq and Afghanistan wars. So actually, since 9/11, 2001, over 100 million people have starved to death on the earth. And they could have been fed for just a small fraction of what the government of the United States spent on the Iraq and Afghanistan war. Does that make any sense to anyone? You know, that 3,000 people allegedly died at 9/11, and then hundreds of thousands have died in Iraq and Afghanistan, but 100 million people have died of starvation, and they could have been fed. Their deaths could have been easily prevented if that was a priority at all among the nations. So yeah, complete bizarro world. So as far as the context of that, if you could do something to save someone from starvation and you choose not to, are you murdering them? You know, if you see a car rolling down the hill, and you just watch as, you know, it approaches someone and runs them over as they're standing in the street, and you don't say anything, did you murder them? You know, that type of situation, that type of question. So what does it really mean when it talks about murder? And there's, you know, there's the, like I mentioned, all the health effects. Okay, so let's say you're making billions of dollars making food products, and people are getting sick and fat, and, you know, hundreds of thousands of people are dying in the United States alone of obesity because your products made them obese. Have you murdered them? You knew that there were going to be people that would die as a result of your products, and you made them anyway. Now they, and again, when we're talking about the food, for example, we're also potentially talking about addictive substances. So we're talking about substance abuse, drug dealing. And yeah, to the extent that they put an addictive substance that then made someone sick, is that, and they knew it, and they did it on purpose, is that not potentially murder as well? So just another concept out there to try and wrap, you know, try and understand. What's the other ones? Idolatry. So the whole world is practicing idolatry on a wide scale. I mean, it's not the get down on your knees and pray to a statue idolatry. But there are lots of things that are idolatrous. Greed is idolatrous. So just You know, and there, and I, there's a verse, I'll put it in the description, but I pervasively in a wide scale manner, people are practicing idolatry. The currency, it's not even money anymore, because money has intrinsic value. So it's currency, and there are idolatrous images that are, people are spending thousands of hours trying to obtain. And so that is a form of idolatry, potentially. Again, and I don't know. You know, I'm not an expert on idolatry, but I know there's a serious issue there, that is being outlined in Revelation that the churches are not talking about. And it's super important, so why don't we figure it out? What else? There's one other. Idolatry, murder, sexual morality. Oh, loving and practicing deception. This is huge, right? Because deception is what caused the mess in the first place, right? Eve was deceived by the serpent. I got it. Adam fired from his job in the garden. And then the rest is history. Mankind and the whole world in a state of continuous decay for thousands of years. So, yeah, practicing deception is not really a character trait that's permissible in a person that's going to live for millions, billions, trillions of years, because they will totally disrupt the society. I hope this video is a blessing to you. I encourage you to repent of your sins, believe in Jesus Christ, and listen to the Holy Spirit.